HCAN TV presents girls varsity playoff basketball tonight. And tonight we have the second-seeded Hopkinton Hillers hosting the seventh-seeded Medway Mustangs in the quarterfinals of the Division II Central Tournament. Hi, I'm Tim Haladic here with Pat O'Brien tonight. And Pat, this will be the fourth time that Hopkinton plays against these Medway Mustangs after winning the first three meetings.
Yes, it's going to be an exciting game. What better place to be in Hopkinton? They're now up high here at the right. Athletic Center and watching Medway and Hopkinton play and battle out for a tournament advancement.
Now, the Hillers are co-TVL champs along with Medfield, and they won those three games. The first game against Medway here at Hopkinton, they won by 30. The second one at Medway, they won by just 4. And then the third time in the Westboro Invitational Tourney, Hopkinton had another big win by 19 points, but then fell to Holy Name in the final. And before that, Hopkinton had won their 15 previous games.
Well, come tournament time, anything goes, and Coach Greco knows that. I was able to touch base with him earlier in the week, and he told me that although they beat Medway three times this year, taking nothing for granted,
right.
You know, the Mustangs gave him a tough battle in each of those three games. Mm-hmm. They're Tri-Valley League rivals. They play each other two times a year, and this is just going to be a real tough game.
It looks like we're handed down to the floor announcer.
Welcome to Hopkinton High School. Tonight's girls basketball Division II South quarterfinals. Our contest tonight features two Tri-Valley League rivals as the visiting Medway Mustangs take on your hometown Hopkinton Hillers. The winner of this game will compete in the Division II South semifinals that will be played at 5:15 on Wednesday, March 8th at Worcester State University against the winner of Marlboro and Groton Dunstable. Participating student athletes, coaches, and contest officials have worked diligently to prepare for today's competition. Please show your appreciation by demonstrating good sportsmanship and respect for all in attendance. Ensure that your behaviors reflect the values that should be identified with these student athletes. Assume responsibility for your behavior and the behavior of those around you. If you require assistance, please call upon the MIAA school or security official. Our great nation has persevered through the leadership and sacrifices of men and women who have served or are currently serving in our armed forces. We invite both veterans and current military personnel to please stand and be recognized. We thank you for your service to our country. And now for tonight's starting lineups. For the Medway Mustangs, number 2, freshman Lizzie White. Number 3, freshman Julia Downing. Number 5, sophomore Nikki Sheehan. Number 11, freshman Mary Kate Gould. Number 12, sophomore Kate Gould Martin. Number 15, senior captain Caleb Beach. Number 20, freshman Brendan Lorenzo. Number 24, sophomore Mary Kate Monahan. Now for tonight's starters. Number 1, sophomore Rachel Costello. Number 14, sophomore Samantha Murray. Number 4, junior Meg Downing. Number 10, junior Riley Childs. Senior captain Kelly Sheehan. The Medway Mustangs are coached by Joe Iannone. And now for your hometown, Hopkinton Hillers. Number 11, junior Callie Corby. Number 14, senior Grace Harpenon. Number 15, senior Allie Mapdoria. Number 21, freshman Olivia Galoot. Number 22, senior Lauren Hamm. Number 25, junior Marissa Prawl. Number 30, junior Elizabeth Roberta. Number 32, junior Reagan Gailey. Number 33, junior Kate Huber. Number 45, freshman Ashley McDermott. And now for the starting lineup of your hometown Hopkinton Hillers. Starting with number 23, sophomore Lily Morningstar. Number 44, junior captain Ivy Gogolin. Number 10, senior Julia Canestrari. Number 12, senior captain Emma LaPasha. And finally, number 31, senior captain Michaela Pucci. And now we ask all those in attendance to please rise, remove your hats, and honor the national anthem.
And in just a few moments, the Hopkinton Hillers will try to get their fourth consecutive win over these Medway Mustangs. Like we said before, the three previous have been wins at Hopkinton, at Medway, and then in the Westboro Invitational Tourney. And in the first round of the Division II Central Tournament, Medway had to play a game. Hopkinton was lucky enough to get a bye. Medway defeated 10th-seeded Neshoba 52-42. So Medway hopefully coming in on some sort of a rhythm, because the last time they played Hopkinton, Hopkinton really had their way with them.
Well, we look at it in a different way, too. Medway's got a little bit of playoff experience on them.
Okay. Right.
They played in the Neshoba. Hopkinton's been resting, but I think they'd rather have been playing.
Right.
So a couple things can happen in a playoff game. You can be nervous, get the butterflies, and, you know, start off slow. You can be over-anxious, and, you know, and here's the tip-off.
We'll see what the Hillers do now. Quick pass down to Morningstar. Thought she had a basket, decided to turn away. Medway swarming defense here to start off a zone. Now the Hillers start to get into their offense.
Medway's doing a nice job keeping them on the
Morningstar perimeter. Takes the space. Scoop layup, no good. Nice drive, though, by Morningstar to start things off. Shot fired from Sam Murray. She gets the first basket of the game. Medway, a 2-0 lead. LaKasha met out of bounds by a Medway defender. Kelly Sheehan got underway. No foul called, but ball stays with the Hillers. Looks like a 1-3-1 for Medway to start things off. Hopkinton will try to figure out this zone. A pass knocked back by Riley Childs.
Well, the thing with the 1-3-1 is they're going to keep the Hillers on the outside perimeter.
Gogolin, tough shot, no good.
So Hopkinton's got to find a way to get the ball in low, because when you got it outside the perimeter and with the three across, you got to get it down low to start collapsing that zone.
And they certainly have the weapons with Michaela Pucci and Ivy Gogolin. Ivy Gogolin averaging a double-double this season. We'll see if she can get going. Medway still up 2-0. Riley Childs drives and draws the foul. On the floor, though, and Medway will inbound.
Hopkinton playing the man D.
pass inside, barely gets to Sam Murray. She steps back, fires another shot, no good. Gogolin with the board. Morningstar in a corner, finally gets it
nice
into Gogolin. Soft shot, no good. She gets a rebound, goes right up with it, and draws a foul on Riley Childs. Childs doesn't look too pleased, but two shots coming for Gogolin.
Very nice pass by Lily Morningstar. Again, looking inside. She found the open player. Got a nice pass in the paint. First shot was missed.
First free throw rims out for Gogolin. She has been a huge part. I mentioned before, she's averaging a double-double. She's been a huge part of this Hiller co-TVL champion season. And they definitely need her to get going as she misses both free throws.
Well, it might take them just a little bit to kind of settle in.
Three-point shot fired from Sheehan. She knocks it down. A quick 5-0 lead for Medway. Canestrari, the nice drive. Dribbles right by Sheehan. Draws a foul. Can't convert, but will be shooting two.
Well, Hopkins kind of changing it up a little bit. They're getting the ball and they're taking it to the hoops, which is good. They draw two fouls. Medway's got a pretty good defense right now with the zone, and they're keeping Hopkins on the perimeter. But they got to make their free throws.
You know, this is the first girls game you've done, and one Achilles heel, if any, for this Hiller team has been their free throw shooting. They've hovered around 50% in a bunch of their blowout wins, which in blowout wins, that's probably not going to affect you as much. But now in a close game, in a tournament setting, they might need to make a bit more, and they're 1-4 here to start. Child steps back, three, too strong. Morningstar grabs the rebound, takes it, kicks it back. Canestrari, three, fired, knocks it down.
There we go.
Big bucket there from the senior, Canestrari, off the pass from Morningstar. And Morningstar tries to steal it away from Rachel Costello, and a foul called. You can hear the crowd not too pleased about that one.
Well, it's always a risk when you go for the steal. Anything that you get a part of the body, the official doesn't have the best angle all the time. And if it looks like a foul, he's going to probably call it.
Tough defense there from Lakasha on Meg Downing. She has to give it up. Hillers with swarming defense now. Any pass is being met with a lot of intensity. Childs drives baseline, puts up the shot, just rims out, grabbed by Canestrari. 5-4 lead for Medway with 5 minutes remaining here in this first quarter. And this time, Morningstar draws the foul. This one on Rachel Costello. She got a bit too aggressive there. Ivy Golden will inbound from the side.
Usually you're not going to get too many steals from the body. You know, when play has the ball and you try to take it away from them, very few times you're going to do it without drawing a foul.
Ball inside to Pucci. First time she touched it, Gogolin turns and fires. She can't get it. Loose ball. And Pucci sticks her hands in there again, fighting for it, and forces a jump ball.
That's what you're going to see. Playoff game, the intensity's up. That extra effort that they're going to put in. Loose balls, balls on the floor. They're going to leave it all out there tonight.
Childs drives now on Pucci, kicks it out. Sheen back inside to Childs. Tough pass for her to handle. Luckily, Medway keeps it. Now Beach drives. Nice pass inside to Murray. Can't finish the and one, but we'll get two free throws.
Medway's been settling for the three-point shot and things from outside. Last couple times, they have taken it to the hoop and gotten a little better shots. That time, drew the foul.
Murray's first free throw is good, her third point thus far. And now the first substitution of the game, Lily Morningstar comes out, and the junior Kate Huebner in the game. Murray's second free throw off the back iron, grabbed by Lakasha.
Okay, little full court press.
Lakasha breaks it. Childs knocks her pass out of bounds. Stays with the Hillers. Gogolin inbounds. Gets it into Huebner. Seen a few batted passes here to start things off as Hockington tries to figure out this zone. Now another one. This one almost a turnover. As Riley Childs runs out of bounds trying to save it. Stays with the Hillers, though. But again, another active hands there from the Mustangs forcing the issue.
Trying to feed the ball inside, which is what I'm sure Coach Greco's advising them to do. And that time, Medway closed the zone and took away that pass.
7 seconds left on the shot clock. Crowd counting it out. Ball gets to Gogolin. Her first bucket of the game goes in from about the free throw line. Now we have a tie game at 6-6 with 3:45 left in the first quarter.
Hopkins is playing a tough man, keeping the Mustangs out on the perimeter.
Sheehan tries to get it inside. Ball taken away by Gogolin. Aggressive pass there from Huebner. Didn't quite have the lead there. Taken away by Childs. Now back on the other end, Kaylin Beach fumbling around with the ball. Gets over to Sam Murray. Her shot just rims out.
Ooh.
And Huebner passes to Gogolin, who had already started running down the court. Another turnover there for Hockington. Now some more substitutions. Callie Corby and Regan Keaveney enter the game for the first time. Now Kaylin Beach swings it over. Murray over to Lizzie White. She launches a three off the back of the rim. Grabbed by Gogolin.
Protect the ball!
Hopkins getting lazy on their passes. Not crisp. Not right to the player. Again, another one.
Another pass, Huebner. That's her third pass. That was either been a turnover or knocked away. Tough start for her, but stays with the Hillers.
It looks like some butterflies in the stomach here.
I would say so. A lot of uncharacteristic play thus far from the Hiller team, who, again, a great season at 18-3. Co-TVL champs along with Medfield. But will this fourth game against Medway prove to be the first time that Medway wins? Ivy Gogolin hopes that it isn't as she banks another shot in. 8-6 lead for Hopkinton.
Well, Hopkinton's been doing a nice job when they take the ball to the hoop. They've drawn a couple fouls. They've got some nice shots right there around the foul line.
Riley Child stuck with it on baseline. Nice pass to Sam Murray. Another shot that just bounces out. And a traveling violation called after Riley Childs and another Mustang got knocked over. Hopkinton had numbers and turned it over.
Well, the transition is going to be a big part of this game because Medway seems to be doing a nice job when they have time to set up and get into the 1-3-1. And Hopkinton does a nice job on their man D. So the transition down the court, if they can get the ball down before the other D gets set up, that could be an advantage to that team.
Riley Childs has it down at the baseline. She steps back for the deep shot. Ill-advised there. Hits nothing, and Gogolin grabs it. Keaveney at the three-point line now kicks it back to Corby. Canestrari thought about it. Drives baseline, gets it poked away. Hits off of her last, and another turnover there for Hopkinton. Nikki Sheehan controlling the ball now for Medway. Shot fired. Knocked down by Meg Downing. Deep two there. Ties it up at 8 with just over a minute 30 left in the first. Emma Lakasha set up to get back in. Nice pass to a cutting Canestrari. She absorbs the contact. No foul. Gogolin cleans up. She can't finish. Michaela Pucci, another offensive rebound, slapped out of bounds. Crowd wanted a foul there on that Canestrari drive. Nothing doing there. Luckily, the Hillers maintained possession.
Looks like the officials going to let them play a little bit, which is usually good on a playoff game. You do not want the officials to be part of
deciding the game.
Exactly. Let the play, as long as they're consistent, that's the best you can ask.
Gogolin frees herself up on the inbound pass, knocks down the baseline jumper. She's starting to heat up. 6 points for her now. Childs with it about the free throw line. Gets it over to Meg Downing. She drives. Nice scoop shot. Can't finish. Gogolin, another rebound. Ball inside to Gogolin. Nice seal from Gogolin. Another bucket for her.
Very nice pass. Like you said, sealed it nice. Here we go.
Loose ball grabbed by Lakasha. Pucci on the run. This is her specialty. She can't finish. Knocked out of bounds. Stays with Medway. Keaveney will inbound. 24, almost 25 seconds left. Shot clock is off. Hopkinton can hold it for the final shot. Canestrari. Again, very similar to a play that happened almost a minute ago. Off of her leg, out of bounds.
Well, the officials are letting some body contact happen because there was certainly some body contact there, which caused the ball to go off her leg.
15 seconds left for the Mustangs. No need to shoot until the final buzzer, but a turnover there. Keaveney grabs it. Now Lakasha with it.
Got 7 seconds, so you can get a good shot.
Gogolin forces one up there. Can't get it, but Pucci grabs the loose ball. She can't finish. And a very rare sight there. Michaela Pucci in the last minute missing two bunnies there. But still, the Hillers have a 4-point lead, a 12-8 advantage going into the second quarter.
Well, part of the atmosphere of a playoff game is when they're going to let some more physicality happen is that players start sensing that. And
right,
they're expecting to get hit. So they're going to adjust their shot. And I think you can see that on a couple of these last shots Hopkins players took. They weren't going up straight. They weren't going up, you know, firm. They're expecting a hit. You know, the body was, you know, kind of off-centered. And
right,
that's going to affect them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something that they're going to have to adjust to. I think they started playing a lot better at the end of the first quarter.
Right.
Those butterflies hopefully are all gone. You know, they're going to get in their rhythm now. They started transitioning the ball from the backcourt to the front court really well, finding the open player in the paint. So looking for a good second quarter from the Hillers.
So the Hillers just 1 of 4 from the free throw line thus far. Julia Canestrari has a 3, and the rest of the points belong to Ivy Gogolin, who has really been a force thus far. Missed her first few shots, but then recovered nicely and has been the spark in this Hiller offense. After a first quarter that was marred with turnovers and ill-advised passes, I think, from both teams, we'll see if, like you said, those butterflies are gone and we can start get to the TVL basketball that we know. Gogolin will inbound here to start things off. Gogolin, Keaveney, Lakasha, Pucci, and Canestrari on the court to start for Hopkinton. Murray, Downing, Sheehan, Childs, and Costello out on the floor for Medway. Tipped pass goes out of bounds. Hillers retain. Gogolin will inbound again.
Medway's doing a nice job defensively, getting a hand on the ball, not making any easy passes for Hopkinton. They're getting a trap now, so they're going to find the open player.
Gogolin, nice pass to Pucci. Great cut. And she wasn't missing that one. Sinks that layup. Now 14-8 lead for Hopkinton.
Well, that was a great pass by the Tri-Valley League All-Star, Ivy Gogolin.
Costello controlling it for Medway. She drives, puts up the shot. Nice drive. Can't finish. Keaveney grabs the board. Keaveney fires the 3. Just off the side of the rim. Hits off the top of the backboard out of bounds.
one of the few threes Hopkinton's attempted in this game. You know, they've been doing a nice job moving the ball, and to beat this 1-3-1, this trap that they're doing, they're going to have to pass quick, get it around, get that defense rotating and shifting, and finding the open place.
Costello drives, Meg Downing drives. Her shot just trickles out. Great pass from Canestari. Bounce pass to Pucci through to a couple Mustangs. I don't know how that one got through, but end result is a Pucci bucket. Now a 16-8 lead, and Coach Joe Iannone of Medway calls a timeout.
Well, great transition. Hopkinton got the rebound, pushed the ball right up court, had the numbers and unselfish play, you know, and made the nice bounce pass for an easy basket.
Now, Pucci had been shut out of the first quarter. Normally, she's a major player here along with Gogolin and Canestari scoring-wise, but Gogolin has picked up the slack, and now Pucci's starting to get active. Once you see the first shot go in, they all seem to start falling.
Well, they've been playing great all year, and sometimes in a playoff game, it just takes a little bit to get going. And you know, Hopkinton's leaders, the three girls that made the Tri-Valley League All-Stars, Ivy and Michaela and Julia, they're going to come to play. And, you know, you'll see before the end of the game that they're going to find their game, and they're going to start making a difference here. They're going to take a leadership role, and they're going to start hitting baskets and making the plays that they've been making all year.
Now the Hillers have gone on a bit of a run here. Now doubling up Medway, 16-8. Fouls are even, 3 apiece.
Putting some full court pressure on them.
Costello again brings it up for the Mustangs. Have not scored in the last several minutes. Childs aims to change that. Plows right into Michaela Pucci. And Pucci draws the offensive foul.
Very nice defense. One of the few times Medway's taken it in the middle like that, and Hopkinton had great position, kept the position, and drew the offensive.
Morningstar draws the defender. Now inside to Gogolin, loose ball taken away by Medway. Costello quick to the other side of the court. Has to turn back, nothing doing on that drive. Pass to Costello on the wing. Looks like she started to make her move before she caught it. Slips through her hands. Turnover, Mustangs.
See Hopkinton kind of packing it down low. They got a couple players down low. They're going to try and rotate the ball, get Medway out of position, and then find the open player.
There's Pucci down low, absorbs the contact from Childs, and then another bucket for Pucci, up to 6 points now, all coming in the last 2 minutes or so. Childs, a nice pass to a cutting Sheehan. Nowhere to go for her except into Ivy Gogolin. A nice scrum there for that loose ball between Sam Murray and Emma LaCascia. Jump ball results in.
No, I think the other official waved them off and called a foul.
Oh, wow.
Called a foul on Medway. When you get those scrums sometimes, end up with a little bit of a foul that not all the officials see. They got 3 officials today. All playoff games, they go with the 3-man rotation. And that gives you 2 more eyes out on the field, out on the court.
Gogolin gets the pass inside. Her shot a bit too strong. Pucci fighting for the board. Gets it out. LaCascia had an open 3. Passed it over to Canestari.
Yep.
And Canestari having a tough game thus far. A few turnovers. Hit the early 3-pointer, but since then, not much has been working for her as she's hit with the traveling violation there. Still an 18-8 lead for Hopkinton with just under 5 minutes left in the first half. LaCascia catches Medway sleeping and comes up behind, pokes out the steal.
Well, that's really smart on Hopkinton. They had it down there. They didn't have a good shot. They didn't rush it. They pulled it back out.
Sorry, an open 3 now. Sorry to cut you off, but
yep.
Off the front rim and an offensive rebound now grabbed by Hopkinton. LaCascia open. bricks that one and grabbed by Medway. Now Costello from three. She doesn't hit anything. Sheehan grabs the board. Tipped out of bounds. Looks like a last one off of Ivy Gogolin. This one will stay with Medway. Now Lakasha will take a seat. She had a chance at an open three, but decided to pass it up to Canestrari, and then Canestrari ended up going down and traveling, and then Lakasha really bricked a three of last possession, but luckily Medway came down and missed a three too. Now Medway will be able to inbound under the Hiller basket, down 10. See if somebody can hit the rim here. Childs looks like she was setting up for the three. She does, off the back rim, grabbed by Morningstar. Morningstar drives, tries to get it over to Gogolin. Too many Mustang hands in the way, and Childs takes it coast to coast. Maybe partially blocked there by Keaveney. Looks like a loose ball foul called on Hopkinton.
Well, Hopkinton is trying to push it, and the double-edged sword on that is you push it down, and you know, either you make it or you don't. Mm-hmm. And you know, that time just wasn't quite there, and Lily tried to push the pass in there, and Medway collapsed on it, and it didn't get through. But all in all, I think Hopkinton's done a great job in the transition game, great job pushing it up court. And I think Hopkinton's got a lot more numbers than Medway. So, you know, they keep running, they're going to tie Medway out, and, you know, it'll pay dividends in the end.
First point for Medway there in several minutes comes on a free throw. 18-9 lead for Hopkinton. Under 4 minutes left. Canestrari launches the three. That one again bounces up over the backboard, out of bounds. Goes to Medway.
Well, Hopkinton hasn't had much luck with the three-pointers, and they have done a great job getting the ball in, either drawing the foul or getting some good shots. So hopefully they're going to bring the ball back in low.
Now Gould, the pass down low to Kaylin Beach. She takes the contact and up and in for the captain from Medway. 18-11 now, Hopkinton. Corby open for three, turns it down. Ooh. Stops, passes it over to Gogolin now. Corby open again fakes, gets what she wants. Nice touch off the backboard. Callie Corby, usually pretty hesitant to shoot, knocks that one down. Pucci on Childs, Childs drives, blocked by Canestrari and collected by Hopkinton. Keaveney pass down low to Pucci. Great defense there from Kaylin Beach to knock it out of bounds, prevent the easy bucket for Hopkinton.
Medway's not giving up. You know, they're playing tough. They're playing a good D. They're quick. You know, Rachel Costello up at the point is really making Hopkinton work hard for the pass.
Keaveney launches a three. Looked good. Just a bit short and grabbed by Costello.
It's nice to see Hopkinton extended Medway all the way back. They're playing tough D all the way there by the, you know, three-quarter line there. So
and Medway having a tough time getting it past the three-point line. Beach does manage to get it. She drives and collects a foul for her efforts. Will shoot two at the line. Beach's first free throw off the side of the rim, no good. Still a 20-11 lead now for Hopkinton as Callie Corby takes a seat. 2:19 left here in the first half. Beach's second free throw off the back rim, corralled by Gogolin. Now Hopkinton on the break.
It's a good pull up.
Canestrari had it, yep. Poked from behind, and a foul there on Medway. Peavany will inbound under the Mustang hoop as Meg Downing enters back in the game. Riley Childs takes what is her... Oh, it was going to be her first break of the game, but instead Costello will take a seat. Peavany trying to get it in. Has nothing to do and throws it off the back of Riley Childs.
That was a smart play. Mm-hmm. You know, when a defender turns around like that, she was running out of time.
Yep, she's not turning around this time. Pass into Goglin, knocked out by Kaylin Beach. Somehow off of Ivy Goglin, though some fans here might think otherwise. In any event, Medway takes over after the Hiller turnover.
Well, with the three-man officials, you're hoping that, you know, they're going to have better eyes and right on there, so they're going to get more calls right.
Beach works through some Hiller defenders. Shot, no good, but again, another foul drawn.
Called outside, so not a shooting foul. Hopkinen hasn't scored in a while, and, you know, I think they've taken too many outside shots. They're not moving the ball as well as they have earlier. And I think it's translating to their defense, too. Their defense doesn't seem as sharp as it was when they were moving the ball well on offense.
And Kaylin Beach draws another foul there, this one on Canestrari. She will be shooting two more free throws. Missed her first two. Third one, nothing but net. And now Canestrari will take a seat. A couple fouls to her name as Callie Corby enters the game. Beach with her fourth free throw. Knocks that one down as well. 20-13 now. Just under 2 minutes remaining in the first half. Hiller's lead. Ball inside to Goglin. Nice soft shot. Can't find the mark. Grabbed by Childs.
Nothing to matter with that shot. You take that all the time.
Childs, a nice pass to Beach. Her shot, no good. Wrestled away by Pucci. And Meg Downing fighting for it.
They got some. Medway's got some scrappy players. Looks like the officials are not calling a lot of contact.
A lot of complaining from the Hiller faithful. But fouls seem to have been pretty even from both sides.
Again, it's the main thing you can ask from the officials is consistency. You know, Bill.
Missed shot there from Medway, grabbed by Keaveney. Lakasha looking over the scene, trying to find where she wants to go. Under a minute left now. Keaveney fires the three just off the back of the rim, grabbed by Sheehan. About a 15-second difference between the game clock and the shot clock. Sheehan fires a three. Short, may have been blocked. Shot clock is off. Hillers can settle for the final shot if they want to.
Ooh,
a tough pass there. Cross court, grabbed by Childs. She takes it the whole way. And one, Riley Childs. Lakasha got caught up there, could not get out of the way. And Childs pumped up after that one.
But Charles did a great job. She was coming down. One person in front of her, she took her right to the hoop. And good things can happen. Either you're going to put it in, you're going to get fouled, or you miss it. So two out of three are good. And she caught two out of the three. She
right.
put it in, and she got
and
fouled.
Got fouled. Yep.
So that's what she needed to do. That's what she did. And bringing the Mustangs a little closer.
And she completes the old-fashioned three-point play. Now Hockington just up four. Canestrari open, finds that Pucci down low. Another bucket for Pucci. A good answer there from Hockington after the big 3 points from Medway. Sam Murray drives, and she gets fouled by Ivy Goglin. Medway drawing a lot of fouls here in the last few minutes. Creeping back into this game with free throws.
They're taking it to the hoop. And, you know, that's what you got to do. And nice job by Samantha Murray to take that to the hoop, draw the foul on Goglin. And Medway's starting to make their free throws, so that's bringing this game a lot tighter.
Murray, 2 of 2 on that trip. 4 seconds for Hawkinson to get something. Lakasha passes it over. Keaveney launches the three. Almost banks it in, but to no avail, and the Hillers will take a 4-point lead, up 22-18 into the halftime break.
Well, I'm sure Coach Greco's got some things to talk about to his players. They were up double digits. They're playing well. They're carrying the tempo. I thought they did a great job bringing the ball to the hoop, drawing fouls, getting some easier shots. And then it seemed like the whole game plan changed. They went to the three-pointers, which they weren't hitting. They're coming back, and the Mustangs were taking it to the hoop, and the Mustangs were drawing the fouls, and the Mustangs were making the basket. So I think Coach Greco will get them all settled in there, get back to what they were doing good in the first place, and the Hillers will turn this thing around.
All right, so we'll be back in about 10 minutes with the second half of the quarterfinals of the Division II Central Tournament. Hope you join us.
Do you have what it takes?
Will you make a difference?
Always an adventure.
Police and fire working together.
Utilizing the latest technology.
Do you have what it takes?
And we are back here in the broadcast booth here at HKM TV. Tim Holadic and Pat O'Brien on the call here in this quarterfinal of the Division II Central Tournament. Hawkinson maintaining a 4-point lead, up 22-18 over Medway, but it seemed like it was a tale of two quarters there. The first quarter, Hopkinton really exerted their will and built a decent lead, and then it seemed like in the second quarter, Medway switched things up offensively and kind of closed the gap a bit.
Certainly, and Medway played a tough defense the whole time. You know, the 1-3-1 zone defense they've played, Hopkinton just seemed to be uncomfortable with it.
Yep.
For a stretch, they're able to rotate the ball, get the ball in the paint, and get some good shots. In the second quarter, they seemed to just rely on the outside three-pointer, which wasn't hitting. So when you miss the shots, and Medway was getting the transition back down, and they were scoring, so that kind of brought the game together. But Hillers didn't win the Tri-Valley League for without a reason, and they've definitely seemed to be the better team out there. In spurts, they've played really well. I'm sure that they'll get things back together. You know, I know coming into the game, as starting the game and starting the second quarter, Lily Morningstar, she'd been battling a shin injury for most of the year. And but you can't really tell the way she's playing out there. She's hustling all over the place, offensive and defensively. She's been doing a great job.
All right, we're about to start the second half here. The Hillers with possession. Finally get the ball in the hands of Emma Lakasha. And now, again, trying to break through this 1-3-1. We'll see what Coach Greco told them during halftime.
Here we go.
Nice bounce pass to Goglin. And a jump ball is called. Great job by Riley Childs there. Not getting any body, forcing the jump ball.
Well, they were looking inside. They had the Ivy cutting to the hoop, try to get the pass in there. So a good sign.
Costello drives, blocked by Lakasha. Out of bounds, stays with the Mustangs. Costello was about to step in for the three there, turned it back, and now Childs, the fadeaway three. She has been ice cold from beyond the arc. Canestrari thought about the three, now gave it over to Gogolin.
Ooh.
Tough pass there from Ivy. She saw Pucci open and threw that one a bit too hard. Out of bounds, another turnover there for the Hillers.
Well, Hopkinton's being unselfish, and she was in the paint, which normally is a good shot. She saw a teammate open underneath, try to get her the ball.
Ball switching hands here for Medway. Childs gets it over to Murray. Her free throw line jumper no good, grabbed by Morningstar.
Talking and setting up and trying to work a play. Canestrari, as you see, along the baseline going back and forth, usually to the side of the ball.
Morningstar, really whoever has the ball for Hopkinton, getting a lot of room. And the whole shot clock has gone down. Not much done for Hopkinton. Quick shot by Gogolin inside. Nothing doing there, but about 25 seconds went by without much happening there for the Hillers. Not a good sign offensively to start. Now Sheehan gets the ball back from Childs. She drives. Not enough there on that layup grab by Gogolin.
Great job defensively by Ivy Gogolin.
Pucci gets the ball, drives baseline, muscles Murray out of the way, but she falls, and Murray comes up with a steal. Morningstar reads that pass, and the ref gets it.
No.
Morningstar thought she had a steal there, but it ends up right in the gut of the referee, and somehow Medway ends up with possession of it.
I'd like to see that one again, because I thought after it hit the official, the Medway player touched it.
And now to compound the mistake, Lily Morningstar gets hit with a foul. Tough stretch right there for the Hillers. Nice pass inside from Costello to a cutting Sheehan. Now Medway within two. Morningstar too late on the pass to Pucci, picked off by Murray. She stops, puts the shot up, and knocks it down. We have a tie game. Canestrari tries to be quick on the drive in a traveling violation. Coach Greco calls for a timeout. Not a good start for the co-TVL champion Hillers here in the second half.
No, and I guess you could say a great start for the Mustangs from Medway.
Right.
But I think part of that is the ineffectiveness of the Hopkinton Hillers. They just don't seem in sync.
Right.
Both offensively and defensively. Transition-wise, you know, they're coming down the court. They're trying to make a cross-court pass or a two-lane pass, and you know, they got to tighten it up a little bit. Medway's defense strings them out up top. Mm-hmm. They got three guys across the foul line extended, and so Hopkinton's having a tough time getting the ball below that.
Right.
So they got to learn to get the ball below that, and then they'll have numbers underneath. And, you know, Medway's just, they're being aggressive. They're putting a lot of pressure on the point, on the ball, and they're keeping Hopkinton on the perimeter.
If they get the ball down low, they do have two TVL All-Stars in Michaela Pucci and Ivy Gogolin ready to score. But the last few possessions, it seems that the ball has stayed in the hands of Morningstar and LaCasha about 3 or 4 feet beyond the three-point line as they struggle to try to get it inside. And then the shot clock dwindles down, and they're forced to take a bad shot. But give credit to the Mustangs. Like you said, Pat, they've kind of forced the issue there. The 1-3-1. A big reason why Medway finds themselves in this game and with a tie score right now.
Hopkinton put it on a full court man-to-man press. They're going to make the Mustangs work for it.
Murray from inside the three-point line, no good. She's a great mid-range shooter. That one did not fall.
Nice pass and one. Yes, you go. Nice pass. Nice shoot.
Julia Canestrari, the nice bounce pass to Ivy Gogolin. She takes the contact. Conley lays it in with the left hand. Chance for a three-point play.
Well, two huge plays all year for Hopkinton. Julia had a fantastic year. She averaged 12.5 points a game, four rebounds, two assists, and two steals. She certainly had an all-around year, all aspects of the game. She was phenomenal. And Ivy, of course, averaged a double-double.
She knocks down that free throw there.
13.5 points and 11 rebounds a game. She came to play.
And good defense there by Emma Kasha, forces a tough pass. Beach can't handle it, tries to save it, but steps out of bounds. A turnover there for the Mustangs. Hillers up three.
Couple good hoops, transitions, and can turn the tide right around, and you can see that right now. Morningstar's back in the ball game.
She drives. Nice play by Morningstar, the floater. Finally, Morningstar must have heard me because she took the ball. She drove past the three-point line, found herself open.
Yep, that's a Hiller ball.
A double kick there off Medway. Rockets the ball out of bounds, and it stays with and it goes to the Hillers. Meanwhile, Coach Iannone from Medway calls a timeout.
So this is where you see the coaches. They know when to use their timeouts. When Hopkinton had their downtime, I think when Medway tied it up 22-22, Coach Greco called a timeout.
Right.
Settled down his players. Told them a few things, came out, scored a quick 5 points. Same thing Medway here.
Yep, now it's Medway's turn.
Now it's Medway's turn. So Coach Greco, talking to him earlier in the week, this is his second year with the girls coaching. He was coaching with the boys for 10 years, and he wants to just give a lot of credit to Coach Keene. Tom Keene has been coaching the boys basketball, had tremendous success with them. Mike was his JV coach. Mm-hmm. Mike did a fantastic job with the JVs, worked with Tom. But Mike's been a basketball kid all his life. He, growing up, you know, obviously played in Hopkinton, and as soon as he could, he was working over at Coach Dick Bliss camp. And Coach Bliss is with us tonight. He's actually keeping the scoreboard over there.
Yeah.
And Mike was a coach and an instructor at the Bliss camp for years. Then when he had a shot, he became a coach over here in Hopkinton and was with the boys. And then the opening for the girls came, and he took it, and he's got them right here into the quarterfinals.
It also took them to a co-TVL championship, the second in school history, first in 10 years, just in his second season. Now hoping to get a quarterfinal victory here against the Mustangs. Morningstar almost travels there, loses the ball.
They're letting them play. We talked about this earlier. Just seems like Hopkins has been on the other end of the plane, you know, getting Mustangs getting physical with Hopkinton. But, you know, that's playoff basketball.
Canestrari open for three, turns, launches, a bit too strong, grabbed by Meg Downing of Medway.
So Hopkins just got to play a sound defense. You know, don't want to take any chances. You want to make them work for everything they got. And you want to make them take the outside shot. The Mustangs haven't really hit the outside shot for the game consistently.
Right.
They've learned how to take the ball in the hoop, draw the fouls, and get the layup. So until they start banging them from the outside, you got to lay off your player a little bit and make them take the outside shot. Once you start getting beat, then you can, you know, get tighter.
Keeveny.
That's a travel.
Yep, there you go. Yep, a turnover there for Medway. And just before that, Keeveny, Corby, and Kate Huebner enter the game for Hopkinton. Now, Huebner will inbound. Medway up 27-22 with 3:43 left here in the third period. That has seen a couple runs from both teams. Medway finally got the game back to a tie score at 22-22, and now Hopkinton has a 5-point lead. Morningstar trying to do a little too much there, throws it into the Mustangs, taken away by Child. She stops just outside the free throw line. No good, but Sam Murray, who has been a force today for the Mustangs, grabs that rebound and is fouled on the putback attempt.
Well, good awareness by the Mustangs. An air ball, she picks it up underneath and puts it right back up, draws the foul.
Murray's got a bit of a line drive on that free throw, but she is 100% from the line here today. Makes her first one there. Now her second one incoming. And she knocks that one down as well. 27-24 lead now for Hopkinton. 3:20 left. Riley Childs picks off the Poochie pass. Quick shot from Childs. Grabbed by Keaveney. And this time, Hopkinton gets the foul as Keaveney's harassed by a couple of Mustangs.
Hopkinton's got to do a better job getting the ball. Violation.
5 second violation there on the Hillers. Another turnover. And it looks like we lost our scoreboard here for you, but we'll be working on getting that back as quick as we can. Mustangs inbound. Childs finds Murray. Dribbles the ball off of Kate Huebner's foot. Goes out of bounds. Medway will inbound again. Downing jumps baseline, tries to get by Poochie. Taken out actually by Poochie, but apparently she stepped on the out of bounds line right before. Turnover there for Medway.
Great D. She took their baseline away, which is the first thing you're going to teach these players is don't let them drive baseline. She had enough of it, and Medway tried to get around her.
Huebner, the nice pass to Gogolin, gets it back at the three-point line. Now back inside to Gogolin. Ivy, the nice footwork there, uses the glass.
Great turnaround. Put it up strong off the glass.
Ivy Gogolin strong with either hand. Opens up a 5-point lead now for Hopkinton. And Kate Huebner hit with a foul there. Looks like she got in front of Medway there, but and honestly, I would say a push off there on Downing, but another foul called on Hopkinton as the foul disparity starts to grow.
Well, from up here, we know they're letting them play physical, mm-hmm. and it seemed like Mustangs were getting away with a lot of physical play, and now they're calling the fouls on Hopkinton, so you just gotta work. You know, you try not to foul anytime. So, but
Downing drives, nothing on that shot. Tries to save it, but it's grabbed by Huebner.
Take it to the hoop.
Poochie drives baseline.
Nice job.
Another basket for Michaela Poochie. Ivy Gogolin got the ball about half court. Knew what to do with it. Got it in the hands of Poochie. Childs drives, a nice left-hand shot, can't finish, grabbed by Gogolin. But Gogolin gives it right back up to Childs. Childs falling, tips it to her teammate. Great play by the junior.
Great effort.
And another foul called there as Beach drives. She's drawn quite a few fouls here today. And Emma LaCascia and Julia Canestrari enter the game. Once again, as Huebner and Callie Corby take a rest. Medway will inbound under the Hiller basket. Down seven with 1:48 left here in the third quarter. Murray gets the inbound pass, launches it, gets nothing, grabbed by Hopkinton. Poochie wants to get inside to Gogolin. Murray, with a great defense, takes it away. No one stops her the entire way, and she banks one off the backboard.
That's coast to coast.
Canestrari steps into the three, knocks it down.
Open, and she took it.
Now an 8-point lead for Hopkinton.
Julia looked very comfortable on that shot. Nice, relaxed. Heck of an act off Hopkinton. Yep.
Great defense there by Canestrari, though. Pushes Medway back a bit.
Cuts the shot clock down to 15, so always nice to reduce your shot clock.
Now 6 seconds left.
Here's another
Poochie
one.
Poochie tips the ball away. She finds herself open for a layup. Fast break bucket for Michaela Poochie. probably got fouled there by Childs, too, who tried to push her away, but Pucci just too strong. Murray, shot, no good. Great defense there from Gogolin. Canestrari for three. Knocks it down. Yeah. Julia Canestrari, another three. Now a 10-point lead, 13-point lead, excuse me, for Hopkinton. Keaveney hit with another foul on a reach-in.
Well, Julia Canestrari certainly looking comfortable out there with a three-point shot. And, you know, those 6 points right now, kind of a little difference in the game. But Hopkinton seems to be, you know, getting a little more confidence both on offensive and defense.
Now it looked like a clean block. Foul probably on the body there as Mary Monahan goes to the free throw line. Her first free throw off the front of the rim, no good. A 13-point lead for Hopkinton with 14 seconds left. Monahan's second free throw up, again short. Grabbed by Canestrari. A jump ball, though. This one awarded to Medway. Canestrari thought she got fouled. Wasn't too pleased there. Now 11 seconds left for Medway to try to lessen this lead, this Hiller lead.
Coach Greco not too happy. He had the ear of one of the officials over there.
Canestrari, another foul. Now Hopkinton, six more fouls this period, this quarter, than Medway. Clearly, referees have abandoned their let the players play mentality, calling a lot of ticky-tack fouls here on Hopkinton. Now Sam Murray finds herself at the free throw line again.
You need a good box out. You need to get that rebound. Nice box out. Now there's a foul. There you go. Hearing it from the hometown crowd.
Some mock cheering here from the Hiller faithful. Finally getting a foul in their favor. 8 seconds, just under 8 seconds now for the Hillers. Shot clock off.
A lot of pressure by the Mustangs.
Canestrari, 5 seconds left now, gets it to Gogolin.
Whoa.
Gogolin probably should have just shot that one herself, tried to get the extra pass to Keaveney. Bit too much on that one. Now Medway will have 1.3 seconds and will not get a shot off. And now the Hillers with a three-point barrage from Julia Canestrari and some fast break buckets from Michaela Pucci now have a 13-point lead going into the final quarter.
I think we're going to be in for a dogfight. This game seems to be running in cycles. Mm-hmm. You know, Hopkinton was a little bit slow to start, and then they got it going, and then Medway came back, and then second half, Hopkinton got it going. Medway came back, and then now Hopkinton got it going. So Coach Greco goes on the bench, and I know talking with him earlier.
The number is Logan, and the number is 7717694. If you would love to put your packages over there.
Just in case somebody at home had that winning number, we wanted to make sure you heard that. But Coach Greco was telling me earlier that, you know, he couldn't really have the year that he had and the team that he had without the help of his assistants. And anyone that knows Hiller basketball know the names of Kerry Chatton and Kristen Waldigger. Kerry's name's up there in a 1,000-point scorer, you know, one of the best basketball players ever to come through Hopkinton. She went to Providence College, and, you know, she played a lot after high school. So, you know, she's a tremendous asset on the bench for Coach Greco. And Kristen, you know, her dad coached here in Hopkinton. She had a great career in Hopkinton. And she's another great asset for Coach Greco.
Michaela Pucci drives baseline, tries to get the scoop layup, blocked out of bounds. Hillers keep possession. Gogolin gets the pass.
Nice touch.
Wide open. Ooh. She can't finish.
Up Keaveney strong. Up strong.
Ooh. Goes up with it, blocked by Childs, and now in the hands of Sheehan. Childs calling out a play, trying to get the Mustang offense going to shorten this 13-point deficit. 10 seconds left on the shot clock. Childs inside, kicks it over to Sheehan. Takes her time for the three. Gets it to bounce in. Hit about every part of the hoop there, but finds its way home.
It did.
Pucci inside to Keaveney.
Kick.
Kick there by the captain of Medway, Kelly Sheehan, who just hit that circus three. 10-point lead now for Hopkinton with just under a minute, gone here in the final quarter. Pass inside to Gogol, and she turns around into Murray. Great defense there. Now Keaveney with the three. No
nice
good.
Position.
Gogolin with the board. She can't finish. Keaveney, her shot can't finish either. Gogolin, another rebound. She can't finish. Keaveney now gets it again. And finally, no made shot, but a foul called.
Well, that's persistent. You know, that was about three offensive rebounds and putbacks. And you know, that one didn't go, but, you know, she drew the foul. And, you know, that's great work underneath by Hopkins and Hillers.
Keaveney's first free throw swishes through. 11-point lead now for Hopkinton. Second one is up and good.
Free throw is going to be crucial coming down the end, because if it's a close game, you know there's going to be fouls and going to try to bring them to the line. So you got to make your free throws.
Medway already in the bonus. Hillers still need a few more to get there themselves. Sheehan drives, blocked by Gogolin, somehow ends up in the hands of Murray. Three fired from Meg Downing, just rims out and grabbed by Gogolin. Now Canestrari open, gets the layup to go. Great pass from Michaela Pucci to find the open Canestrari.
Great job taking it right to the hoop. Off the ball. Couldn't be quite sure who that foul was on. I think it was off the ball.
I know the Hillers don't look too pleased with that one. Again, feeling like they might be being picked on here a little bit.
See, they got to make sure we get the right player at the free throw
line. Yeah, one referee not quite sure what's going on. Corrected there as Childs will take the free throw. 1-1 off the front rim. And grabbed by Medway. Sheehan, a tough falling shot, almost made it. And Childs reads that pass. Great defense there from Childs as Lakasha was open down low. But Childs takes it away, fires the quick three, way short. Kaylin Beach, offensive rebound, another lucky bounce from Medway. Now down 12.
Something the Hopkins has got to look. They don't want any turnovers.
Gogolin, great decision there. Hits Pucci, cutting on the pass. And finally, a Hiller will be shooting free throws as Michaela Pucci goes to the line for two.
Well, it's tough to change the way you play the ball game. And Hopkinen certainly has an up-tempo transition game. They push the ball. And, you know, you don't like to change it. But sometimes when you look at the score and you look at the time, you know, and you want to make sure that, you know, you don't want to make turnovers, so you can slow it down a little bit. Use up a little more of that clock. Because a lot of times in the transition, you know, you push the ball up court fast, and if you turn it over, you're giving it right back, eating up very little time.
Pucci, one of two from the stripe on that trip. Lily Morningstar enters the game again. Her presence is going to be key here. She's probably the best on-ball defender that the Hillers have, shin splints and all. There she closes out on the three-point shooter and...
that's a travel.
Her and Canestrari tried to grab the ball, and Canestrari is hit with the travel. Beach looking to get it in. Does find Childs just before the five-second violation. Childs inside to Beach. Nice bounce pass from Beach to Murray. She can't finish. Childs, a good offensive rebound. But tipped pass by Pucci results in a jump ball between Ivy Gogolin and Kelly Sheehan.
Medway's not going to go easy. They're going to make this a tough for Hopkinton.
Pucci sticks her hand up at the last second, knocks the pass away. Sam Murray short on the shot, a wild shot on the offensive rebound there from Childs, and this should be.
Ooh. Great hustle by Morningstar, but it would have been a backcourt,
and she almost lost the ball. So,
yeah.
Well, the fans might think that's great hustle. Yeah. Probably not the best play there for Morningstar, but luckily for Hopkinton, they keep possession.
And sometimes when you're playing, you don't know who the ball went off of and that, so you see an open free ball and you go after it. So you can't fault anybody for that effort. That was great speed and great effort. And there's another foul on the Mustangs.
Yeah, Lakasha tried to get the ball over to Morningstar. She was fouled on the pass. Gogolin inbounds under the Mustang hoop and gets it into Pucci. She, by herself, baseline, nice drive, just lost the ball at the end when she tried to finish the shot. Sheehan, the long pass from Childs, she can't hit the three. Now Childs open from three. No good for her. She got to be approaching 0 for 10 from three-point line.
Well, they're only down 13, and, you know, no need to panic. You know, they're playing well. You know, no need to just keep healing up the threes.
Gogolin, the nice move, takes the foul. Can't finish, but a great play from Ivy Gogolin as she forces the issue and now will shoot two from the line. And a timeout looks like called by Coach Greco.
Well, Hopkinton seems to be settling in now. You know, they got the two timely threes from Canestari. And then, you know, they've had some nice transition baskets. That right now, Ivy taking it to the hoop and drawing a foul. But they really seem to be settling in more, both offensively and defensively.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, this team, again, like I said, didn't win the Tri-Valley League, you know.
For nothing.
And, you know, we know the stars. You know, we know the captains. And, you know, we know everything that they did. But Coach Greco, besides having his assistant coaches, really wanted to tell me what a great team he has, and he really couldn't have had the success that he had this year without a complete all-overall team.
They're a very deep team.
And a lot of the players don't get the recognition because they don't get a lot of playing time,
mm-hmm.
but they're there at practice every day. They push the starters. They make the starters better, and they make that team better. And you know, he mentioned in particular Rhys Prawl, Lauren Hamm, Liz Liberta, Allie Maffery, and Grace Macquadon as really giving everything in practice and making the starters work for everything they got, which translates to better play during the game. And the coach just mentioned those names, but he just said everybody on that team came to practice every day and helped make this team just so good.
And it will be up to the starters now to finish this one off as Gogolin hits her first free throw. A 14-point lead for Hopkinton with just over four minutes remaining. She sinks the second one. And the winner of this game will play on Wednesday at 6 p.m. at Worcester State University in the semifinals of the Division II Central Tournament, where actually the Hillers lost last year. And they will play the winner of Groton Dunstable and Marlboro, which is going on right now.
Well, the good news is they're higher seed than both those teams. They had a better record, which doesn't always translate because you're playing in different divisions and stuff. But quick, timely timeout by Coach Greco. You know, good call. He sees his player, in trouble. And she's just about to get double teamed, picking up the ball off the ground. So he wisely called a timeout.
Yep, Morningstar did end up breaking out of that one, but Coach Greco wasn't taking the chance. Called the timeout. 3:49 left here in the fourth and final quarter, hopefully for the Hiller fans, up 13 and looking for their fourth win against Medway, which would be quite an achievement because now I think we're both in agreement. We think the Hillers are the better team, but it's still tough to beat a team four times in one season.
Well, it certainly is, and you know, you can see just how hard Medway wanted the game. They're playing tough. They haven't given up yet. And the game's not over. 3:49, and you know, a lot of things can happen. I would tell the Hiller fans that even though you and I both had 6 o'clock for the next game, mm-hmm. they announced 5:15
right,
earlier.
Right.
So I'm not quite sure what time the game is, but they should check for sure.
Pucci gets the inbound into Gogolin. Hawkinson will be looking to drain most of the shot clock each and every possession. Canestari, the deep three, knocks it down. Canestari has found her stroke here in the fourth quarter in the second half. Nice pass inside from Beach to the captain, Kelly Sheehan. Now 14-point lead for Hopkinton. Again, Hawkinson trying to use most of this clock. Lakasha drives, gets the bucket to fall.
See, a lot of times you see that and you think it's a foul, but the defense has a right to be where they are.
Right.
And she basically ran into the defense. As long as the defense doesn't hit a shot.
Three-pointer fired from Julia Dowling. No good for her, and grabbed by Hawkinson.
So you're going to see contact sometimes. You're going to see people go to the ground. Sometimes they're off balance, but not necessarily always a foul.
Canestari again from three. No good. Crowd is ready to go wild.
Oh, she's out of bounds. Great effort by Ivy.
Ivy and Kaylin Beach fighting for that loose ball off of Ivy. And now the Mustangs take over. Hawkinson trying to put the final nail in the coffin here. Under 2:30 left here in the fourth, up 16.
You know, I really haven't seen Mustangs hit the three, so, you know, I think I'd stop against that.
And Kelly Sheehan drives, draws the foul.
And let him hit a couple threes before I worry about that. You know, keep him in front of him. Don't foul them driving to the hoop. You don't want to give them a three-point play that way.
Right.
But they haven't really shown that they're able to hit the three-pointer from the outside.
I believe Kelly Sheehan, who's shooting the free throws now, has been the only Medway player to hit a free throw. Childs has tried and tried her hardest, but the three-point shot is just not working for her tonight. Both of Sheehan's free throws bounce out. No points there for Medway on that trip. Pass knocked out of bounds. Looks like it'll stay with the Hillers. Canestari with it at the top of the key. Again, the Hillers trying to use as much time as they can.
Oh.
Morningstar with it now.
Oh.
Gave it to Gogolin, who just turned around to get it. Morningstar now with it. 1 second left and tied up for a jump ball. They called a shot clock violation. I thought the jump ball happened before, but they end up calling a shot clock, and now Mustangs with it. Over 1:30 left here in this fourth quarter. And Beach tried to drive baseline, ended up stepping out of bounds. Now, I thought Medway's going to start fouling, but maybe they will now with 1:33 left, down 16. And there, a quick foul on Emma Lakasha.
Well, you'll start seeing it now, and looks like we'll be shooting the one-on-ones. And Emma Lakasha just wanted to point out that she was the three-point shootout champion for the leadership. Let's see, what was it? It was the Metro West officials versus cancer. And Emma won that three-point competition.
Gets that free throw to bounce in. Now a 17-point lead for Hopkinton. She will have one more.
This is where you want to try to create some space and pass the ball, and don't give them an easy opportunity to follow you.
Second free throw from Lakasha, no good. Childs, the shot down low, that bounces in, and Coach Iannone calls a timeout for Medway. Down 15, the Mustangs are, with 1:21 left. They're going to need some type of miraculous comeback here.
Well, sometimes, and I'm not quite sure of the free throw accuracy of the players, but, you know, with Coach Greco, you know they're going to foul you. So you want to, on the five you want to put on the floor, usually you want to put on your best foul shooters.
Right.
Because you're going to go down and, you know, they're not going to let you eke out 30 seconds off that clock.
Right.
So you want to put quick, good ball handlers in. And from what I see, everyone, including, you know, the bigger players, they're mm-hmm. all good ball handlers
right.
and good passes and, you know, good free throw shooters. So, you know, normally sometimes, you know, teams have their big center who's not a good free throw shooter. You know, at that time you may want to take him out and replace him with another guy just to – have someone that's able to shoot free throws and handle the ball a little better. But
mm-hmm.
I think Hopkinton, their top 5, 7, 8 plays that they've been playing all game, any one of those he'd feel comfortable being out there.
Right, and the Hillers, who have fought all season for this advantage, the home court advantage, definitely nice for them here in the last few minutes. And overall this game, the fans showed up in force.
Oh, boy.
Here's a foul.
Yep. Okay.
Actually, probably better for Hopkinton the foul wasn't called. Looks like Medway has conceded, as far as my eyes can see. Lakasha hit with a travel, though. A few feet outside the three-point line, Medway will take over.
Yeah, looks like Coach Greco is bringing in some substitutes and giving his stars a well-deserved rest.
Allie Mafior, Lauren Hamm, Grace Marcadont on the court for the first time. Marissa Prawl as well.
Not quite sure what he called there. Looks like he called a travel. Or he just called, the timeout was called just for substitution purposes.
And Mafior can't find Corby on the inbound pass there. Hiller's up 13 with just under a minute left. And barring anything, like I said earlier, barring any type of miraculous comeback, looks like the Hillers will be at Worcester State on Wednesday. Again, we recommend you to check that time before you get there, because we have 6 o'clock, but before the game they said 5:15. But either way, the Hillers will be at Worcester State University on Wednesday in the semifinals against either Groton Dunstable or Marlboro.
Well, looking out here, Hopkinton had a great crowd here tonight, both students and adults. They packed this place. They were loud. They were certainly opinionated, and, you know, they –
That's the price of admission, though, right?
You got it. And some good free throw shooting.
So the question at the beginning of this game, would it be possible for Hopkinton to beat the same team 4 times in one season? A pretty remarkable feat. Looks like they will get that done as Riley Childs gets the and one. With 30 seconds left, now Medway down 11. Missed free throw results in a jump ball. This one goes to Hopkinton. In the Hillers, the second seeded Hillers will improve to 19-3 overall, while Medway will drop to 14-8. But a good season for the Mustangs nonetheless, who had to deal with the loss of 1,000-point scorer Sarah DiPillo, who graduated last year. A big loss for anyone to deal with. But Coach Iannone has done a great job of coaching up the girls that he has to get them to this point. I'm sure the future will be bright for Medway, but the future is now for Hopkinton.
Certainly is. And, you know, they had some great basketball tonight. I think they had a couple spots where, you know, they just didn't keep it all together,
right.
But, you know, they showed what they have. They certainly got the talent. all aspects of the game, you know, shooting, rebound, passing, defense, and, you know, they definitely should be contenders for, you know, next game, whether it's Neshoba or Marlboro. Or Groton Dunstable.
Yeah, Groton Dunstable or Marlboro.
Yep.
But seeing this Hiller team, I know you said that seeds aren't necessarily as accurate when there are teams from other divisions, and that's true. But seeing this Hiller team play all season against a tough TVL, and actually the number one seed is Medfield over on the other side of the bracket, so maybe we will see a TVL final. But I believe these Hillers definitely have what it takes to get it done. We'll see if they can get it done on Wednesday. Again, at Worcester State University.
Well, they got some time, and I'm sure Coach Greco's got somebody watching that game.
Right.
So they're going to have an idea of what Marlboro or Groton Dunstable are going to be playing. So, you know, they got, you know, several days to
right,
to
yep, enough
practice.
Time to get something done. 5 second violation. Nope, actually a timeout called. 10 seconds left. Hillers up 12.
Well, it didn't really make a difference if you're one or two seed because you're going to play each other at the
right.
end. There's not going to be a home court advantage in that game.
Mm-hmm.
The only difference might be, you know, the one would be playing a four seed and the
right.
two would be playing the three seed. But otherwise, Hopkins has seen Medfield twice. They
mm-hmm.
know what each other can do.
Right.
Medfield's got an outstanding basketball program year after year. And, you know, Hopkinton kept up with them this year, sharing the Tri-Valley crown.
Mm-hmm.
A lot to be proud for here at Hillerland.
And their streak before that loss to Holy Name, they were blowing teams out, which may have kind of actually hurt them when they finally played a close game against Holy Name. But here, a tough, scrappy game against Medway team that did not want to be swept this season by the Hillers. But we saw the Hillers show up after a kind of lackluster first quarter. And now, as the clock runs out, the Hopkinton Hillers will advance to the semifinals of the Division II Central Tournament again on Wednesday against either Groton Dunstable or Marlboro.
Fantastic win by Hopkinton. I think we saw, you know, that they were the more talented team.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone they put in just kept the pace up. You know, they had their five starters. They came in with their substitutes, and they didn't miss a tick. They played a great man defense, and, you know, they were able to move the ball. Great transition from defense to offense. Julia just got hot at the right time, I think.
Right.
That kind of took a close game and kind of, you know, stretched it out a little bit and give some breathing room from Hopkinton. And once that happens, you know, Medway started taking some, you know, ill-advised shots, and,
right.
you know, they weren't quite as confident as they were earlier, and Hopkinton did a fantastic job.
And the season of the Medway Mustangs ends here in the quarterfinals, thanks in part due to the great performance there by Ivy Goglin and Michaela Pucci and the rest of the Hopkinton Hillers. The Hillers improved to 19-3, and once again, we will see them on Wednesday, March 8th. And we suggest that you check the time because we had 6 p.m., but before the game they announced 5:15. But either way, Hopkinton will be there on Wednesday, and we hope to see you guys there. Thanks for joining us here in HCAM. I'm Tim Mulatic for Pat O'Brien. Have a good night, everybody.